I met him in 1939. It was December, Hanukkah, in at our time. I met him at my aunt's gourmet shop where he used to buy chocolates for his children. And there I met Sugihara, who was the consul of Japan in Kaunas. And I was staring at him, and my aunt said, "Don't stare, come and meet His Excellency Consul Sugihara." And we shook hands and he smiled at me. And that was the beginning of a friendship between the 11-year-old Jewish boy from Kaunas and the Japanese consul. I used to go there almost every week to get some stamps. I was collecting stamps from at that time, and he would give me an envelope with stamps, and then I would get some cookies from his wife and tea from Yukiko, and I would play with Hiroki. He was much younger than I was. I was 11 years, about 5 years old. So before the Soviets entered Lithuania, I was there quite often at their home. I was very fond of them. They always treated me very nicely, and he always, right from the beginning, he didn't treat me as if I was a little boy. And what actually happened was at the shop, when my aunt brought me some money for the Hanukkah money, he also gave me some money, and I told him I cannot accept it because he's not a family. But he said, "So for this Hanukkah, I'll be your uncle." So I said to him, "If you're my uncle, then you should come to a Hanukkah party," which was Saturday. And that's how it really started between not only myself, but also the family. My family was very astounded, and it was a very interesting meeting, and Sugihara was asking many questions. He spoke perfect Russian. Especially, it was interesting because at that time, we had a father and a daughter who ran away from Poland as the war had already started, and the Nazis occupied Poland, and the many Jews fled from Poland across the border to Lithuania. And Lithuania was still independent at the time, and the Jewish families were taking in those refugees. So my family, my father and mother, adopted a man and his daughter by the name of Rosenthal. During that evening of the Hanukkah party, Mr. Rosenthal approached the consul Sugihara and asked him if he would give him a visa to escape from Europe. He was very astounded, and he asked why would he want to go to Japan? That Lithuania was at that time still independent, and Rosenthal said that he's sure that the Nazis will come here too. And Mr. Rosenthal had a chance to tell his story, and he told them how it happened, how the Nazis were bombing Warsaw. He was from Warsaw, and a bomb hit the house, and his wife and two other children were killed in the bombing. And he and his daughter were rescued, and that's why they decided to run away from Poland, because he knew that the Nazis will kill all the Jews. So he told his story, and Sugihara was listening very carefully of what he was saying, and made an impression on him. And so Sugihara, at that time, it was December 1939, was kind of puzzled to think that anybody would want to go to Japan, especially a Jewish person, because the Japanese were then allied with the Nazis. So that, I think, was the first idea planted in his mind that afterwards resulted in handing out the visas to Jewish refugees, mostly Polish refugees. until June 1940, when the Soviets entered Lithuania. And things have changed completely. Then, at that time, Lithuanian Jews became Soviet citizens. I mean, not immediately, but became the Soviet Republic of Lithuania. So mostly those who were had Polish passports or were from Poland, refugees, were able to receive the visas from Sugihara. What happened was that many of those refugees were lining up to get visas from anybody who was willing to give them. But very few gave visas at the time, and the Jews were desperate. And then about 6 months after the Hanukkah party, the Soviets entered Lithuania. We received the visas very early, but our passports were Lithuanian. And when the Soviets entered, it became invalid. But we did try to escape once. I remember we went to, when the Soviets were still there, when Rosenthal and his daughter already visa, and they went to the train station to get on the train to went to Trans-Siberia to Vladivostok. And we also went there, and then we saw that the KGB, at that time they were called NKVD, were standing and checking every paper and every passports. And we knew that if we try to get into the train, they'll probably arrest us or send us to a gulag or something. So we went back home. Later, Yukiko, his wife, wrote a book called Visas for Life. There's a picture of me, and in which she writes that Sugihara's idea to give out visas to Jewish refugees may have been influenced by a young boy by the name of Soligano. So that's, I have that book, and she signed that. So I doubt that this could be true, but he was just a good man who saw that nobody else was helping the Jews. That was one of his ethics, to help people who come to him for help. There was a Dutch consul in Lithuania by the name of Swartendijk, who was initiating visas for Dutch citizens. There were some young people studying in yeshiva in Lithuania who, after the Nazis occupied Holland, they came to him and asked what to do. And he suggested that they should try to go to Dutch colonies by the name of Curaçao and Suriname, which is in the Caribbean islands. And so they got the visas, and then many people who came to him who wanted to get Sugihara transit visas through Japan came to him as well, because Sugihara needed an end visa where the people would go from Japan, because he couldn't give him an end visa to Japan. So this was the combination between Swartendijk, the Dutch consul, and Sugihara. And he would give visas to Suriname or Curaçao, and Sugihara would then give transit visa through Japan. And the people would then go through Trans-Siberian railway to Vladivostok, from there to Kobe, Japan, and then of course, they never went to Suriname or Curaçao. Those who went stayed in Japan. And most of them landed in Shanghai during the war. It's known as a fact that the Nazis, especially Eichmann, demanded from the Japanese that he should return all the Jews to be gassed. You know, and the Japanese sent all the Jews to Shanghai in the ghetto. I heard they said the Japanese told the Nazis, we don't have any Jews in Japan. That the story goes that Sugihara was friendly with one of the NKVD agents, what today is KGB, and before the Russians entered, and they made some sort of arrangement. I think what I heard was that the Russians were bribed by money given by the Jewish committee, American Joint Jewish Committee. And this is what was known as, because the Russians weren't exactly happy to let all these Jews go through Russia to Vladivostok. And actually he also gave out visas to the whole Mirror Yeshiva, which is now part of it in Brooklyn, part of it here in Israel. I met some those who had visas, square visas, in the United States, some of them in Australia, some of them in Israel. One was a particularly political person who was head of the Mizrahi movement, who escaped from Poland to Lithuania, and his name was Mar Haftik. And he arrived in Israel, and then he became the first minister of religious affairs in the government of Ben-Gurion. You should take an account too that from Lithuania he was sent to Germany, and he knew he was going to go from Kaunas to Königsberg. First he went to Königsberg for I don't know how long he stayed there, but that was a risk he took too. The Nazis of course knew that he gave out visas to the Jews, so he went, that was going straight into the lion's mouth, and you never knew how the Nazis would react, you know, to a person who it was saving Jews. He disappeared after the war. I went to Israel. I was in Germany as interpreter with the American Army for a while. And then I went to join the army in Israel in 1948, the War of Independence. And we never heard of anything about Sugihara, what happened to him. We were totally disconnected. It was only later I heard that he was found by Israeli consul or Israeli attaché who was rescued by him. And he was looking for him in Japan, and nobody wanted to tell him where he is. The thing is, we should go back and say that he made inquiries from the Japanese Foreign Office whether he can issue visas, because there are hundreds of Jews lined up at the consulate who want to get Japanese visas. And what should he do? And they told him in no uncertain terms that there's no way allowed to give visas to Jews, because at that time they were negotiating with the Germans. But nevertheless, he still decided to give out visas. And I heard that before he died, they asked him why did he go counter the orders he had from his government. And he said, I had to make a choice to follow my government or follow my God. After the war, when he arrived back to Japan, he was fired by the Japanese government, and according to Yukiko, his wife, he was fired because he disobeyed the orders. There's something you don't do in Japan, you know, especially such an important order as not to give out visas, and yet he went ahead and did it. And later, when I was in 1992 or 94, I was in Japan, invited by Mrs. Sugihara to come for the opening of a humanities park in the name of Sugihara. There was an ex-prime minister of Japan who, he didn't deny that they fired him because of that, but he spoke very much in favor of Sugihara, of what Sugihara did. 2 years ago, I received from Kaunas a message that the emperor and his wife came to the consulate, which is now in the museum, for the name of Sugihara, came to visit the consulate in Kaunas. the fact that the royal couple, which is in Japan much more than just a royal couple, went all the way to visit the consulate, and so he was very impressive and very polite, and they stayed there for quite a while in the consulate, looked in every room and looked at the pictures. And actually there was a picture of me there too. So I think that the Japanese realized that they actually have a hero on their hands, and whatever he did, he counted the orders, still he became an international hero. When I found out that Sugihara received from Yad Vashem the Raja among the nations, I was kind of surprised that the first time I heard about him and why I didn't hear before, because we were in contact with Yad Vashem as a survivor. He received the nomination. He was too ill to come to Israel already. And then a family came, I think it was Yukiko and Hiroki, and I'm not quite sure because I was in California at the time. But somehow, so I wrote to them, I don't remember how I contacted Yukiko. And she immediately responded, and she remembered us very well because we knew each other until they left Lithuania. And so she invited me and my wife to come for the opening of the park in Yaotsu. And that's how we renewed our friendship. Then she came when I was living in San Diego at the time, she came to California. I traveled over there to San Francisco as a group and to Sacramento, where there was a small exhibition. And then my friend Eric Sol put up an exhibition of Sugihara in the Wiesenthal Center, 1996, I'm not sure. It was a quite very big exhibition. And the Wiesenthal Center actually put up a bust of Sugihara in the main hall. So his name became already very widespread. And at that time, when we were in Los Angeles, she was invited with her family, and we were invited too by Spielberg. Most important people of Hollywood came to that party, and Yukiko Sugihara came in her Japanese kimono. So and Spielberg introduced her, and so that his name and her name became very widespread due to the exhibition in Wiesenthal Center, which was dedicated to Kuni Sugihara, the hero from Japan. So then afterwards, we went to the capital of California, which was Sacramento. And also the government received her very nicely. So I had a chance of accompanying her all over California, wherever she went. Well, she told us that he actually came to her, and he said, "What should he do?" And he told her, "You know, we have 3 children, and the risk of disobeying the orders can be severe." So she agreed that he should visit us.